Everything has changed. The streets are empty, shops, schools and public venues are shut. People have been sent home to work or just laid off. In Britain, we are clapping for the National Health Service once a week, the same NHS that has faced decades of underfunding and privatisation. Despite being a wealthy country, hospitals aren't getting the resources they need. The death toll keeps rising and frontline staff are among the victims. Something is going wrong. The world is in lockdown, governments are throwing money at the problem, but their failure to prepare is costing lives. For decades, we have been told that only the free market ensures efficiency. Now this global health crisis brings the very concept into question. It has exposed the values and contradictions at the core of each society. So what should be done to save lives and livelihoods? For years, I have been researching Cuban development. During lockdown, I've been writing about Cuba's response to the COVID-19 pandemic. I haven't been able to go to Cuba because they've closed their borders, but I know some Cubans who will be able to help me find out more. Hi, Valia!
Hi, Helen! Good to see you! How are you?
I'm good! How are you? Are you going to be able to go to Cuba? Because I know you were planning to.
No, unfortunately not. The borders are closed, airports are closed, so I cannot go.
So we'll have to find another way to get in touch with some of your old colleagues in the scientific pole in Cuba.
Yeah, sure. I don't think there will be a problem, Helen.
I am a Cuban medical doctor and a scientist that used to work at the Cuban Neuroscience Center, that is part of the scientific institution below BioCuba Pharma.
Cuba has a population of 11.3 million. The first confirmed cases of COVID-19 on the island was 11 March. At that time, Cuba had over 97,000 medical doctors, together with 84,000 nurses, 150 hospitals and 449 polyclinics, 111 dental clinics, 132 maternity homes, 155 old people's homes, 295 adult daycare centers, 30 psychopedagogic medical centers, 29 blood banks, and 12 medical and research institutes. There are 48,000 family doctors, which 26,000 works in the community.
Buenos días. ¿Cómo estamos? Bien. Bien, nada nuevo. Todo normal, todo normal. ¿Están para atenderse ustedes? Sí. A ver, pase uno de ustedes para acá conmigo. ¿Edad, Lina?
66.
Estoy laborando como especialista de medicina general enteral en este consultorio alrededor ya de 31 años. En ese trabajo nos desempeñamos en la atención y prevención y rehabilitación de la población que atendemos. Atiendo una población de alrededor de 800 personas que está dentro del mismo área de atención donde estoy y con identificación de todos sus riesgos, de todos sus hábitos, logrando de que la salud de esta población tenga una calidad la que se espera por este primer nivel de atención de salud. El médico de familia es, felizmente, y tenemos ese orgullo y lo decimos, fue creado por nuestro comandante en jefe Fidel Castro, la modalidad en Cuba, o sea, el médico y enfermera de la familia, que tuvo su fundación prácticamente en el año 84. Ya llevamos prácticamente 36 años de fundar el médico de familia. Y es el médico que trabaja en la comunidad directamente con la población. Yo me siento orgullosa de ser una de las que integro ese gran ejército, porque es, yo digo siempre que es lo primero que tú ves, el paciente, el primero que ves al médico de familia. y llega a ser parte de la familia, porque llegas a ver la historia de la familia desde que empieza en un embarazo, ves el producto del embarazo, o sea, ves nacer el niño, ves toda la trayectoria del niño, ves su adolescencia, ves su adultez y puedes llegar a ver hasta su vejez si los años no los permiten, ¿no? Pero es el médico esencial de un sistema de salud, el médico de familia.
That is the other key principle of the Cuban health system, that is focused on prevention over cure. And that is very important for a poor country because in that way, it's not only that you are saving resources, so it's cost effective, because people, they don't need to go to the hospital, so problems are solved very early on in the community, but also you can guarantee a better life, so a better quality of life for people.
En esta atención primaria de salud, nosotros normalmente distribuimos la población por grupos etarios, por grupos dispensariales. Por grupos dispensariales estamos hablando de los clasificamos en grupo 1, que son los pacientes supuestamente sanos, grupo 2, los pacientes de riesgo, el grupo 3, que son los pacientes que ya tienen una enfermedad crónica no transmisible, y el grupo 4, los pacientes dispensarizados, dispensarizados con alguna discapacidad. Entonces, en ese grupo están los 820 pacientes. Y según su grupo dispensarial, pues les vamos dando la prioridad de seguimiento que deben tener. En eso se basa fundamentalmente el trabajo. Sin dejar de hablar del resto de los programas. El médico de familia nos permite también trabajar en un grupo, resto de programas, que estamos hablando de alrededor de 54 programas. Son los que normalmente trabajamos. Tenemos diseñado organizaciones de masa, los CDR, o sea, los Comités de Defensa de la Revolución, la Federación de Mujeres Cubanas, la Asociación de Combatientes de la Revolución. Son factores que están en la comunidad que también nos han apoyado en la pesquisa de buscar los posibles sospechosos en la comunidad. Y ya le digo que con ese engranaje de todo el mundo trabajando en función, el área no ha reportado ningún caso positivo.
Somos las estudiantes de medicina. Somos las estudiantes. ¿Cómo están?
Muy bien, muy bien.
¿Todo bien? My name is Jennifer Hardy. I'm a third medical student. I started on March 10th, and we are doing it since today. We do it 100 houses per day. We go every day to the homes that we know there are people in danger. The first thing we do it is knock at the doors of our neighbors, and we ask them how they feel, if they have fever or cough or any symptoms that are from COVID-19 or some other sickness, because we don't only we are asking for COVID-19, so we are asking if they have maybe other respiratory sickness.
El trabajo del médico, la enfermera y la familia es el más importante, porque es el que está trabajando en la base, es el que está prácticamente diariamente viendo al paciente, es el que está diariamente en el terreno, tanto en este contexto. Sin el trabajo del médico, la enfermera y la familia, creo que todo el resto de que sigue en el Sistema Nacional de Salud Cubano no se pudiera realizar. Es el médico más importante, es el equipo más importante en esta pandemia. Es el que usted ve en la pesquisa, es el que usted ve visitando las viviendas, es el que ve que está haciendo el trabajo social, inclusive llevándole a este paciente vulnerable hasta los medicamentos. Es el médico de familia. Por lo menos en nuestro país es el más importante.
Muy querida con nosotros, que vive en España, y el día 13 de marzo ella llegó a Cuba y a los 2-3 días comenzó a sentirse malestares propios de la enfermedad. Acudió al médico, la ingresaron, por supuesto, le diagnosticaron el COVID, y nosotros entonces tuvimos que también ingresar para que se nos estudiara, a ver la posibilidad que había de que también nos hubiéramos contagiado, y así fue, quedamos contagiados en ese entonces.
La especialista de epidemiología del municipio nos comentó que nuestra amiga había sido positiva. Ellos vinieron en una ambulancia, nos recogieron aquí en la casa y nos trasladaron hacia el hospital. O sea, hay un sistema de la salud pública que cuando hay alguien contagiado se recoge en su casa o posible contagio y se traslada hasta el hospital que se decida.
I think the isolation and the quarantine center has been also essential in the control of the pandemic. And that measures, also we have experienced before, I mean, the country has experienced before, given the medical collaboration that we have sustained in many countries with infectious diseases for a very long time. So there is a tradition of a quarantine and isolation as a preventive measure for not entering diseases through the border. So that helped to understand the situation. Also, we have like dengue pandemics in Cuba, so we also have, or the country has the experience about quarantine a part of the population when was necessary to control spreading. And that was vital in this case.
De allí no podíamos movernos, no nos iban a dejar salir del hospital. Sucediera lo que sucediera. Estábamos bajo un régimen de aislamiento y de tratamiento que es inviolable y no íbamos a poder salir de allí.
Realmente fue muy triste porque estábamos, imagínate, encerrados también. Después ya nos separaron. Mi papá se fue a terapia, estuvo en terapia intensiva casi más de 10 días, entubado, entonces, y crítico además, un riesgo de muerte. Entonces, para nosotros fue realmente una experiencia súper, súper, súper fuerte. Yo creo que es una de las experiencias más fuertes que yo he vivido en toda mi vida.
As part of the response to COVID-19, the biomedical sector was given the task to repair equipment that were broken, and they were difficult to substitute or to repair because of the US embargo. So the Cuban Neuroscience Center, the place where I used to work for 25 years while I was in Cuba, was one of the leading institutions in this effort.
Some of the things we've been doing is, for example, trying to reduce the cost of the PCR tests, which are very necessary to identify if a person has the virus in his body. These are very expensive. They can ruin a country. If you want to do, as you should, testing of everybody that's been in contact with a person that's been ill or that has some kind of symptom, or just random sampling, that could ruin any country because they're very costly. So what we've done is work together to see how we can manufacture locally in the country everything that's needed for the PCR tests. The other thing we've been working on is trying to manufacture ventilators. The reason is immediately as soon as we started seeing how the epidemic was playing out in Spain, in China, in the UK and other countries, we saw there was a very large shortage of ventilators and that people would die because there wasn't enough ventilators at the peak moments of the epidemic. Luckily, we've never had such a big peak that our intensive care units have been, you know, our capacity is exhausted. I think all the measures that have been taken in the country, all the steps to control the spread of the disease have allowed us to flatten the curve. And there's never been a number of cases to overburden our intensive care units. But just in case, we prepared for the worst scenario.
Since I still keep collaboration with them, we were talking in which way we could support the task that was given to the scientific poll for repairing equipment. And then we decided that one way of working around the blockade was to start a campaign, a crowdfunding for collecting funds and then buying different spare parts that were difficult for Cuba to acquire given the US sanctions.
We're going to build two types of ventilator. One is the invasive ventilator, this one where you intubate the person and you administer air, a mixture of air and oxygen to the lungs to help the person breathe. We used a design that was developed by the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT, in the US, and they placed this as open source on internet. Of course, we had to adapt it to our materials, our conditions, but I think this was a very favorable instance of international collaboration. And we'll be delivering to the public health system 250 before the end of the year, 250 ventilators. This will help us prepare in case we have a second wave or if we have an increase in the number of cases. The other ventilator we're working on is one which is not invasive. It's one that you don't intubate, you just use a mask or a helmet. It's for, let's say, less severe cases. And this is based on the design, open source, by UCL, University College of London. And they have collaborated with us. We've had teleconferences, discussions, and we're now manufacturing 250 of these ventilators.
As part of this campaign, we made contact with the University College London, with the department that has developed a Ventura UCL CPAP device. And then they, in a spirit of collaboration, they gave us a unit for the quality control of the equipment, the CPAPs that Cuba was building. That was another example how collaborations and solidarity can bring people together for facing a common problem, that this is the case of this worldwide pandemic.
When you have an underdeveloped economy and you still are not strong, many of these things are extremely costly. So for example, if you want to do neonatal scan, screening of metabolic disorders, diseases, these are diseases you can detect when the child is born and probably prevent mental retardation or other diseases. But if you want to do this for every single child in the country, and you have to buy it, and if you're a poor country, it's impossible. And since our health system is based on the idea that anything we have has to be universally available for everyone, because the Cuban health system is free for all, it's a universal coverage, and then that created the need for an independent and self-sustaining national industry that will reduce the cost so we can take it to everyone. So this big response to COVID, is the COVID-19 pandemic, is I think a product of these two developments. The idea that we had to have complex, big organizations to be able to help handle health issues, and this was a lesson from our first dengue epidemic, and the need to have a self-sustaining and independent national industry to reduce the cost to make it universally available.
This is not a rich country. I mean, it cannot do many things that perhaps could be possible to be applied. But anyhow, it has been a very good result. But I think that it's not only due to science and to biotechnology. It's mainly due to the organization that the society took from the beginning of the pandemic.
I think the coordination that was established from the very beginning was essential for being able to face the pandemic and to take the right decision. The involvement of the government establishing a central group that is also called core group, bringing together all the different parts, entities, and institutions, what allows to put resources where the resources were needed at the right moment and to take the right decision in a very dynamic way.
Our government has listened carefully to science. Every week, there's a meeting of the president, our president, Miguel Díaz-Canel, the prime minister and the vice prime minister, all these, leaders at a very high level in the country, and they meet with a group of scientists who present their results, their discussions. I've had the opportunity to participate several times when there's been a discussion of the ventilators or of the problem of the PCR tests. And I'd say that the central coordination group facilitates a nationwide response. But the interesting thing is, it's not something which is enclosed in the state apparatus, but there's a close talk, a close communication with the scientists. And this problem of, I'd say there are two things that characterize the Cuban response. First, the government and our society has worked with the worst case scenario. So we've prepared for the worst. So the idea that a government can be over optimistic and work with best case scenarios, we've seen it could be disastrous. And the second thing, it's listen to science. So it's continuously listen to scientists, discussing with scientists. And this is very important because this is a scientific problem. So this is a problem you can handle differently according to your ideological or political point of view. But deep down, it's a problem of humanity fighting a virus. It's biology, it's science, and it has to be handled scientifically. And if you ignore science, you get into trouble.
This is not the first time that Cuba, and particularly biotech, has to play a role in a pandemic. We have pandemic many years before, for example, against dengue, against a kind of neuritis, against hemophilo influenza type B, a kind of bacterial meningitis.
Let's say we have in place in Cuba two things which helped us react and help us organize, let's say, such a complex and let's say a large scale response to COVID. The first one is a long tradition of collaboration between, let's say, the universities, the research centers, the public health system, and the government. And this was something that many years ago started off as what was called the biological front, and it was created personally by Fidel Castro. So he organized a meeting, he called together scientists from the universities, from the research centers, from the Ministry of Health, and it was in response to a big dengue epidemic, the first dengue epidemic we had. And Fidel, I remember, talked to us and said, we cannot be caught unaware again. And all the big research centers that were being created, like the Center for Genetic Engineering, the Center for Molecular Immunology, our own center, which we grew up in, let's say, within another center, which was the National Center for Scientific Research. All this is a response to that dengue epidemic. And the conclusion is we had to create a strong biotech sector and biomedical research center to respond to that kind of thing. So then that they called a biological front, or Frente Biologico, it evolved into what was called the scientific poles. And these were organizations, again, where you had the universities, research centers, you had factories, and you had people from the Ministry of Health. And the idea is collaboration with technology to handle big health challenges. And all this came out from this very first dengue epidemic we had many years ago.
He created in 92, 91, 92, the what was called the West Scientific Pole of Havana. That was the biggest organization in biotechnology in the whole Latin America at that moment. And later on, he continued pushing, creating conditions, and stimulating the people working in biotechnology. I mean, he dedicated many years and many hours and all the time required to be able to develop practically from the scratch the biotechnology in the country. He is really the father and the conductor of the biotechnology in Cuba. We'll be right back.
Cuba nosotros no competimos entre las instituciones, al contrario, colaboramos, nos potenciamos, nos apoyamos mutuamente. Eso es una característica de la ciencia en Cuba. Es un país con muy limitados recursos, no nos podemos dar el lujo de competir. Pero además la naturaleza propia del sistema socialista cubano y de la salud pública cubana, que es universal y gratuita para toda la población. Son instituciones que pertenecen al gobierno, al Estado, y nuestro fundamental objetivo es resolver los problemas de la sociedad. Es decir, no lucramos con los productos que desarrollamos y por lo tanto no tenemos este conflicto.
A mí nadie me preguntó cuando entré en terapia intensiva si yo era de izquierda, de derecha, ateo o católico, nada. Nadie me pidió una tarjeta de crédito, nadie me dijo cuánto me costaba la cuenta, nadie me dijo si tenía un seguro médico y me atendieron como si yo hubiera sido el paciente más importante del mundo. Así atendían a todo el mundo.
This idea of complementing each other was since the beginning of the Cuban vaccinology. And this is the same what is happening now with the vaccine. I mean, it's not something new. It's a kind of a way of thinking, of behavior.
Cuba era un país con un 40% de analfabetismo cuando triunfó la revolución. Un país donde la ciencia eran iniciativas aisladas, no había instituciones científicas como tal. Y desde un inicio, la mayoría de la población no tenía acceso a la salud pública. Y desde un inicio la revolución priorizó la salud pública y la educación como un programa a largo plazo, un programa estratégico a largo plazo. Primero, alfabetizar a la población. Después, alcanzar diferentes grados de escolaridad. Después, que todo el mundo tuviera acceso a la universidad, todo gratuito. Y ya cuando se logró tener una masa de personal universitario, instruido, pues entonces la prioridad fue el desarrollo de la ciencia y se comenzó a invertir en el desarrollo de la ciencia. Mucho se debe a la visión de un hombre, de Fidel Castro, su humanismo y su preocupación por el desarrollo social desde los inicios mismos de la revolución, y esto se programó estructurado para un país con limitados recursos como Cuba.
The whole development of science and this biotechnological center has received a personal attention from Fidel. He visited all these centers. He would discuss with the scientists, and this was a message to the rest of the government: this is what is important. The future of the country has to take into account the development of science, of knowledge, of technology, and this is very important.
Es muy significativo a partir de los años 90, cuando ocurrió la debacle del sistema socialista en Europa del Este y Cuba se introdujo en una profunda crisis económica por la caída de las exportaciones en un 35%, etc. En situación en que en cualquier país del mundo lo primero que se recorta son los presupuestos de investigación, de educación y de salud, en Cuba la prioridad fue la ciencia y desarrollar nuevos centros de investigación. En ese periodo se inauguraron nuevos centros de investigación y se dedicó recursos sustanciales a la investigación científica. Y eso ha sido una estrategia a lo largo de todo el periodo de la revolución que se ha cumplido y que permite mostrar los resultados que hoy mostramos.
Since we can say something like 81 have been using the very close collaboration of different entities, including scientists, in the struggle against the pandemic. And in the case of this pandemic, what it has been done in a very useful way is to use all the different kind of development that exist already in order to be able to avoid complication of the people having the COVID-19. For example, that is the case of biomodulin T, interferon alpha 2B, alpha plus gamma interferon, Usbinsa, and monoclonal antibody against interleukin 6. We also have been used ozonotherapy in order to destroy phenomena at the level of blood coagulation. And we also have been using other kind of therapy like convalescent plasma. All these kind of product have been very important in order to reduce the lethality due to the virus.
También desarrollamos el péptido Husvinsa, que es para el tratamiento de la tormenta de citocinas en las unidades de terapia intensiva, es decir, pacientes graves y críticos. Y disponíamos ya en el centro como producto el factor de transferencia, que es un producto natural obtenido a partir del plasma de la sangre y se usa para potenciar la respuesta inmune y se está usando también para la prevención de grupos vulnerables, de grupos de riesgo de la población, ancianos, etcétera, se le administra este producto. Son productos ya introducidos, desarrollados y establecidos en el protocolo. Y también estamos desarrollando productos que todavía no están introducidos en el protocolo, sino que están en investigación, en estudios clínicos. Tenemos antivirales, tenemos vacunas para potenciar la inmunidad innata, vacuna no específica para potenciar la inmunidad innata en general, que no solo servirá para COVID, sino para otras enfermedades infecciosas. Y trabajamos también en una vacuna, candidatos vacunales específicos contra el COVID. O sea, en todas estas áreas estamos trabajando y desarrollando productos.
In the case of alpha interferon 2, concerning the pandemic, when the pandemic started in Wuhan in China, we contact our colleague in China, and we propose them to use interferon. Then there is a company working in Changchun. Changchun is the capital of Jilin in China, in the northern east of China. And they proposed interferon to the commission in China. And it has been admitted as one of the 30 products to be tested in this pandemic. I mean, this was proposed by us. They accepted that, and later on, when in March, it started to be already present in Cuba, the virus, we started to use the product.
China fue el primer país que comenzó a utilizar los interferones, interferón alfa cubano. De hecho, tenemos una empresa mixta en China que produce interferón alfa. Después muchos países se han interesado por el interferón y se le ha vendido, se ha suministrado interferón a muchos países. También el péptido para el tratamiento de los pacientes graves y críticos, que es un producto nuevo, está actualmente en estudio clínico en México y está en conversaciones con muchos otros países para realizar estudios clínicos. Es decir, es también uno de los propósitos nuestros es poner estos productos a disposición de otros países. Se ha exportado a muchos países y se está en conversaciones con muchos países para estudios clínicos o uso directamente de los productos.
The blockade affect almost in all the different possibilities the development of science in Cuba, particularly biotechnology. This is a real a situation that for us creates a lot of difficulty in terms of the process to get a drug approved by some of these entities and to get in the market. I think it's something that we have worked and we are going to continue working in that direction, but it's really very difficult due to this situation I explained you before. The American market is so important that if a company that want to have relationship with us, they want to get inside the American market, they know that they are going to have trouble. It's true that we don't have the same kind of results that Europe or States, but we have enough capability in terms of technological and scientific background in order to approach a new development like this one or the vaccine. We, as you know, are in two projects concerning the vaccine candidate for COVID-19. The clinical trial of the vaccine started already, phase one, and phase two, they announced it's going to start rather soon. The vaccine is what is called a subunit vaccine, and this is a kind of vaccine that normally have more possibility to be saved than other kind of vaccines. The Finland Institute, that is the leader of the vaccine in our country, if finally everything is achieved during the first month of the next year to get already a vaccine against COVID-19.
El país ya tiene registrado en el registro de ensayos clínicos una vacuna específica que está en fase 1-2 de evaluación clínica que fue desarrollada o está siendo desarrollada por el Instituto Finlay de Vacuna, otro de los centros pertenecientes a BioCuba Pharma. Aquí en el Centro de Ingeniería Genética y Biotecnología estamos trabajando en candidatos vacunales, pero que todavía no están en etapa de investigación clínica, están en etapa de desarrollo aún.
In our case, if we produce the vaccine and we protect our population against the disease, it will be a very important result, even if we only get the result. But our interest will be not only to protect the Cuban population, also to participate with other countries if we get the vaccine in the protection of the population.
The fact that it's a centralized health system, which is free for everyone, universal coverage, allows an efficient deployment of whatever resources we have. We could do better if we had more cash to buy more materials. But the fact that we have a national industry that allows us to produce most of the medicines that are used for treating pandemics or epidemics or any kind of diseases, that we have a national production of different kinds of medical equipment. For example, for immunological tests to see if antigens are related to any disease or the antibodies are circulating in the body, every municipal has a lab. So as soon as they set up a test and start manufacturing the reagents to do the testing, it's immediately distributed all over the country. So of course, it would be much easier if we didn't have such a difficult economic situation and if we didn't have this continuous persecution by the U.S.
There's no doubt that the United States increased its hostility towards Cuba during the pandemic time. Basically, they enforced 43 additional measures to the 200 blockade measures that were taken during Trump period. So we are talking that in the first semester of 2020, right, there have been 43 actions specifically designed to upgrade the siege against Cuba. I think that the United States government philosophy has been to take the COVID-19 as an opportunity to enforce and upgrade the embargo or the blockade against Cuba. They've made an assessment that the combined effect or impact of the US blockade reinforced for the last 4 years, together with the crisis that a country will experiment at dealing with the COVID-19, will make Cuba more vulnerable in terms of its capacity to react to such a challenge.
I'd say that the other problem is that the world economy in this moment is in a very bad shape. And it's not only us. If you want to buy basic materials and things you need, supplies, for manufacturing ventilators, we've reached we reached out to certain countries, tried to buy materials, and we've been told that they can't be exported because they're being reserved for local use. Or sometimes we try to buy something and the supplies are exhausted. So I'd say another problem. So we're suffering like everybody, the consequences of the pandemic on the world economy. But I think with the additional factor that we have the U.S. embargo and this attempts by the U.S. government to strangle us that are also making things difficult, much more difficult. We had all of our chromatographic systems in Cuba were manufactured by a Swedish company called LKB. Then overnight, there was an acquisition of LKB by a US company. And immediately, we had to change all the systems in the country because they communicated that they could no longer sell to us.
El bloqueo nos ha afectado muy significativamente en el intercambio científico, en el acceso a recursos. Cuba está bloqueada financieramente en el sistema financiero internacional, en el acceso a tecnología, a la compra de equipos, sobre todo equipos de alta tecnología que se producen muchos de ellos exclusivamente en Estados Unidos y está legalmente prohibido venderlos a Cuba, en el mantenimiento de los equipos, en el suministro de piezas de repuesto para los equipos, en la compra de reactivos, muchos de los cuales, o la calidad de los mismos es de empresas norteamericanas, hay que comprarlos a través de terceros países, evadiendo el bloqueo, realmente es muy complejo y implica costos muy altos este bloqueo y realmente eso nos afecta muy significativamente.
It is true, as you know, that it harmed Cubans badly in terms of hardship, of the long lines that you see on the street, of days that we had a blackout, of days that a vessel could not touch Cuba, or touch Cuba but could not deliver their cargo, because at that time a phone call from Washington was made to Lloyd's or to any insurance company in the world saying, hey, if this vessel named Claudia leave their cargo in Cuba, we will punish you, or we will take away, or we will put a fine on you according to their illegal biggest system of sanctions and unilateral coercive measure that exists in the world. The most apprehensive, the most enforced for the longest period of time.
Realmente no se puede decir que hay aislamiento total. Hay muchas cosas que sí se comparten, sobre todo en el sector académico. Pero en el sector empresarial, las compañías, pues hay competencia. Cada una trata de salir con sus productos adelante. Es un problema de mercado, de quién vende más. ¿Entiendes? Y esto es una limitación que tiene el desarrollo hoy en día, no solo en el sector farmacéutico, sino en todos los sectores. En vez de cooperar para desarrollar más eficientemente mejores productos, todo el mundo trata de desarrollar un producto diferente, porque el que ya desarrolló otro o está desarrollando otro ya lo tiene patentado. Entonces ya el otro tendría que licenciar la patente. O no se la licencia, entonces no le queda más remedio que en vez de aprovechar lo que ya se desarrolló, tiene que hacerlo diferente. Y esto, lógicamente, va en contra de una mayor rapidez y una mayor eficiencia en el desarrollo de los productos.
The most important thing for many people is not to get a position in an American company or an American university. It's to have good results in order to be useful and to get better possibility for you and your country. I mean, it's a contradiction in the sense that the embargo creates a lot of difficulty, but the embargo get also create the, we can say, the decision to overcome difficulties and the decision to be better and to have important results.
El sistema de salud cubano es un sistema de salud sólido. Yo lo considero un sistema de salud sólido, independientemente de todo lo que pudiera globalmente pasar con Cuba. Pero es un sistema de salud sólido, organizado, es priorizado, y en la pandemia nos lo ha demostrado nuestro país, nuestro gobierno ha priorizado el sistema de salud. Si usted prioriza el sistema de salud, todo lo demás va a salir. Cuba se organizó, Cuba preparó a todo su personal de la salud, Cuba preparó unos buenos protocolos y Cuba lo llevó a nivel de todo el país. Y no queremos, y no puedo faltar de decir, y lo llevó también internacionalmente.
En 2005 hicieron un llamado para atender a los pacientes que víctimas del huracán Katrina. En ellos escogieron un grupo de médicos que estuvieron en primer lugar dispuestos y que tuvieran cierto entrenamiento en desastres, en epidemias. Y en este caso nosotros habíamos pasado un diplomado de atención a desastres y estuvimos ahí preparados para salir para Katrina aproximadamente 2 meses. El gobierno de Estados Unidos decidió no darle autorización a los médicos cubanos a participar. Pero eso sirvió de marco, ¿no?, para la inauguración de la brigada Henry Rick en ese año, que la primera misión fue ese año, que en un deslave en la República de Guatemala estuvimos ahí participando en atención a esos pacientes que quedaron expuestos a muchas epidemias, sobre todo de enfermedades transmisibles, porque habían perdido prácticamente la infraestructura completa. Y participamos por un periodo de 3 meses y ahí se dio inicio a la Henry Rick. Con posterioridad se inició la epidemia de ébola en África Occidental y fuimos llamados y decidimos participar por voluntad propia en el combate al ébola en África Occidental. Y ya con esta experiencia previa, entonces ya yo me sentía con la obligación moral de participar en una brigada que fuera a combatir el COVID, lo mismo en Italia que en otro país del mundo.
United States have been doing an active harassment of every single government on earth that have any agreement with Cuba. The best probably example was that famous Bravo Bolivia, that Pompeo clapping on cameras when Bolivia expelled Cuban doctors at a moment that they needed the most. That was a decision that cost life, probably thousands of lives. So, but they will just make the phone calls. It is true at the same time that they failed. And in fact, the pressures start at the very beginning, and most of the countries that will need Cuban medical aid put their population also before. But some of them had to pay a price for it. They will blackmail people, I mean countries and governments, with visas, and we do have that information because the governments of many of those countries told us they will blackmail them with visas, with international aid. And if you look at the map, you'll see what was the flow of donation of the American government in our region. You'll see that the international aid, again, was not set up in terms of who needed the most, but it was again carrots and garrot and sticks in order to price some and to punish others. But at the same time, they were not able to put doctors where Cuba will send them. So it was impossible, and that's why it failed.
Nosotros nos llevaron a hacer un tour por el cuerpo guardia y vimos pacientes en camilla, ventilados en cuerpo guardia con ventilación invasiva ahí en cuerpo guardia. Vaya, un caos, ¿entiendes? Las terapias colapsadas, llenas de pacientes y el personal muy, muy cansado. Entonces nosotros lo que hicimos, hacer un hospital anexo, un hospital de campaña, que ese colapso del cuerpo de guardia sencillamente se pasó hacia esa zona, los alivió, los descansó, porque no es lo mismo tener un paciente, atender tres pacientes en una camilla, que atender lo que tú estás diseñado a trabajar.
They weaponize Cuban solidarity. They have weaponized and criminalized Cuban solidarity, and they wreak havoc in many countries. So we can just mention what happened in Brazil after the massive withdrawing of Cuban medical brigade because of the threat and the actions of a hostile right-wing government, favorite government in town of the United States, Trump government in Latin America. Lots of people lose forever the first doctor that they have received or medical attention that they have received in their life. So most of the places where Cubans were working, now they don't have people to replace them.
Es que es una necesidad, es que la medicina es un derecho elemental del ser humano. No importa en el país que viva, donde esté. Es una responsabilidad de los gobiernos garantizar la medicina y la educación. Esos dos factores son esenciales para la vida de cualquier país del mundo. Y lamentablemente no hay países en los que esto no son cosas primordiales, ni esenciales, ni obligaciones de algunos sistemas políticos.
Es una decisión propia y personal y moral y me gusta servir a los demás. Me gusta servir por voluntad propia, no porque nadie me lo imponga. Hay un proceso de selección. Si tú tienes un médico que ya tiene cierta experiencia en bioseguridad y va a participar en una epidemia, tienes ese aspecto y no una epidemia como el ébola, ¿no? Que la bioseguridad era el centro de todo el trabajo. Ya tienes eso adelantado, entonces se llamaron a las personas que tuvieron el ébola. ¿Estás dispuesto a participar? ¿Quieres participar? ¿Deseas participar? ¿No tienes ningún problema para participar? Y si tú querías participar, te unías al grupo.
The United States failed on its campaign. In fact, during the pandemic, we dispatched more than 52 medical brigades to around 39 countries or more. And the response has been really a response of gratitude, as it should be. They are not going there for them to be thankful. I think Cuba is not pretending anything. It has been part of our history to be solidarious. We also have been benefit from international solidarity, even now in times of COVID. We will never forget the country that has helped Cuba, the international organizations or governments that have helped Cuba in this difficult moment, even private organizations or private people. But we will not forget either that on times of pandemic, on times of hardship, the United States capitalized on their despicable policy against Cuba.
Es una justificación para atacar las misiones cubanas. Yo nunca me he sentido como un esclavo, nunca. Yo he tenido capacidad de decisión sobre mi vida, en primer lugar, que un esclavo no tiene. Yo he podido decir que sí, he podido decir que no, he podido decir que ahora no porque no quiero. Yo nunca me sentí un esclavo. Y entonces eso me parece que es una forma de justificar el bloqueo, de justificar las medidas contra Cuba, de tratar de dañar una fuente de ingreso para Cuba. Es más de lo mismo, más de lo mismo.
You cannot call a slave to a person that voluntarily will go to work in a foreign land. So it doesn't apply all of the requirement. It's not forced labor, so people go voluntarily. Second, it's not on pay. Cubans are paid. In fact, they are paid more than the normal workers in Cuba because they receive in Cuba their entire salary, And at the same time, they do receive also an stipend or an allowance or a salary. It depends on the different contracts in the country when they are working. So it's not forced labor, there's no use of force. And the reason that US called that a slave for human trafficking has nothing to do with the international felony of human trafficking. It has to do with the necessity that the United States has to justify a policy that is impossible to hold in front of public scrutiny. United States cannot tell the third world countries that it is right to prevent people who need medical service to give up to those service by the Cuban medical brigades just because they don't want it, or just because it doesn't match their policy to have international recognition, admiration, that is not new.
La experiencia más, yo siempre digo lo mismo, la experiencia más notable que yo tuve en Italia es prácticamente avanzar por una calle alrededor de un kilómetro. No porque tienes que caminar por ahí, porque debíamos llegar a una plaza y éramos de grupos en grupos. Usted sabe lo que es caminar más de un kilómetro y la gente, toda la gente, salir de su casa a aplaudirte. Eso fue una experiencia inolvidable. Yo creo que yo como eso no he visto ninguno. Por la espontaneidad, por la forma en que la gente te aplaudía, te decía gracias, gracias, gracias. Y además por el tamaño de la cantidad de gente que salió a aplaudir a nosotros.
La atención médica en ese hospital fue realmente excelente, excelente, excelente. Yo no puedo decir otra cosa. Yo sentía que los médicos y la enfermera eran como un familiar mío, porque me trataron a mí de manera, con una dedicación y con un amor increíble.
Me siento más tranquila. Y ahora que veo que el país está en una situación un poquito más controlada, han bajado el índice de casos, pues me siento mucho mejor. Cuba, de verdad que los médicos, bueno, a lo mejor no tendrán mucho, pero tienen un gran corazón, un gran amor por la carrera que estudiaron, por sacar adelante cada enfermo, eso sí es cierto.
Realmente, en ese sentido, yo creo que a pesar de la experiencia tan fea que vivimos, tan triste, tan negativa, si algo hay que rescatar de eso es el valor humano del personal de la salud pública en Cuba, que realmente se la juega día a día y se juega la vida realmente por amor a su oficio, literalmente así, por amor a su oficio.
I am very proud of my country. I knew that was going to be like that. But seeing actually that has been like that, and knowing how hard it's for my country and for the people in my country is to live every day with the US blockade, and how much the population is struggling, my family that is still there, it made me even prouder. It's prouder of that. I am really proud.
Tens of thousands of people have died in Britain of COVID-19 and the country's gone back into lockdown. Cuba, meanwhile, is opening up to its new normal. Total deaths are less than 150, and to date, not a single healthcare worker, pregnant woman or child has died of COVID-19 on the island. Isn't that remarkable for a small Caribbean island subject to 60 years of sanctions? By reacting quickly and decisively, by mobilising the public healthcare system and the state-owned biotech sector, the Cubans have kept contagion and fatalities down. They have also treated patients and saved lives overseas. Within 7 months, nearly 4,000 Cuban medical specialists had been to 39 countries to treat COVID-19 patients. Cuba spends a tiny proportion of what is spent in Britain and the United States on healthcare. But by planning its scarce resources, they are able to organize the kind of effective response we've seen during this pandemic. The key to Cuba's success has not just been the fact of state intervention, but the nature of that intervention. Cuba's socialist system is set up to prioritize welfare over private profit. Now, this may not be a lesson that most nations are ready to hear, but Cuba's international assistance during the pandemic at least shows the feasibility and the benefits of global cooperation to address global problems.